And then we ranked those five models using the AI6 scores. Lastly, we looked at timing of metamorphosis, and we used generalized linear models to assess the probability of metamorphosis over time. And we used accumulated thermal units to assess the timing in order to get any anything temperature related that could hinder development. So these are the metamorphosis rates, and this is really the effectiveness of the chokes. That's what this is. So on our y-axis there, we have that increase in metamorphosis rate. And there's really four standouts here, and which are our four best hosts, which was walleye, smallmouth bass, black crappie, as well as brook trout. And then all the other ones were kind of mediocre, really. So you can really tell that, you know, it's important to figure out that effectiveness, right? All of these produced at least some juveniles, but there's a huge difference between a good host and a bad host. So it's a little summary of the host fish models. So again, with these AIC scores, we're talking about best to the worst. As far as those go, species was the best, followed by diet and native. Those were the three with significant B values. And just to dive a little bit deeper into that, I looked at the significant parameters from each of those models. And to no surprise, for a species model, it was the four best hosts were significant parameters there. But then the diet model, this diverse and carnivorous fish were significant parameters. So again, we're kind of getting at these traits that might be able to help us predict what other hosts that didn't try that maybe did. And then lastly, for the native model, oddly enough, non-native fish were actually significant. And that gets us to the timing of metamorphosis. So on the y-axis there, we have this increasing probability of metamorphosis. And then along the y-axis, we have the accumulated thermal units. So this is how we assess time. And this is just for one, right? So this is just yellow bullhead. But then we did that for all of them, right? And this is kind of like a lot. It's like a lot to look at. So that's why I wanted to look at the one first. But upon looking at this a little bit longer, trying to figure out what kind of differences we might be able to see, we kind of noticed that the four best hosts seem to be metamorphosizing sooner, right? So then we ended up grouping the viable versus non-viable hosts together, and we see that that's actually true. So we're just starting to look at this now, and what might be causing that, we're not like totally sure. We think it could be something to do with the immune response of a not-viable host. They could have a stronger immune response, right? And they may be hindering the metamorphosis, right? So if they do metamorphosize, it takes them longer because of the immune response of the fish. Again, that's just like a gasp, right? We don't really know, but that could be why. Lastly, we have a few host trends here. So obviously, viscivorous and carnivorous fish seem to be best, which makes sense, right? We've got the large mantle lure of the lamp mussel that kind of just confirms what we already thought. But then we have this like non-native fish thing going on, and I'm going to chalk that up to study design. I think if we had more fish, native, non-native, if we just like picked different fish, we might have seen different results there. So I'm not going to put too much weight to that. And then I mentioned striped bass before, and I think this is kind of an interesting thing to talk about. A lot of people in our field feel that this migratory host is probably the historical primary host for yellow lamp mussel. But then it brings up this question of, well, there's a lot of barriers to migration now, right? There's a lot of dams, not to mention some populations of yellow lamp mussel reside beyond natural barriers as well. And I think that maybe some of these non-native hosts may have filled that niche, right? They're no longer interacting with striped bass in a lot of situations, but smallmouth bass and walleye are really abundant in most of the rivers in the Atlantic slope ranges. So they could be serving as the primary host now. And then as far as management propagation goes, it's kind of nice that these are pretty popular sport fish. So as fisheries managers, an easy kind of side benefit, and we can manage for these popular sport fish, and as a benefit, we might help the mussels out. So that's nice. And then as far as propagation goes, if anybody ever is looking to propagate yellow lamp mussel, this can help inform your lamp. This is right. So, smallmouth bass, smallmouth, pretty good host to use. Just a few next steps. We should really back this lab study up with confirmation of hosts with natural infestation. So actually going out in the field and seeing if, you know, these yellow lamp mussel Caucadia are actually attached to fish in the wild. So just to confirm what we did in the lab. I think there's opportunity for more advanced modeling, just to help predict the most likely host in the wild. So again, you can probably use some of the results that I have from my study, but then also pair it with some variables that might make the fish more likely to interact with those mussels in the wild and be able to build some pretty good models. And then lastly, there's definitely some other fish that should be tested in the future, which include longnose gar, bowfin, as well as jig. And with that, I'd like to make a few acknowledgments. My advisor at SUNY Oneonta, Paul H. Lord, co-advisor, Andrew Gashalandis at SUNY Cobleskill, Dan Stitch, he's here, but he obviously helped with all the R stuff. And then as well as my funding contributions that I received from SUNY Oneonta, as well as Upper Susquehanna.